Right, so welcome back to the fifth episode of my beginner tutorials for Kerbal Space Program, where today we are going to land a Kerbal on the moon and bring him, or in this case her, back to Kerbin safely. And standing by here on the launch pad is the, my design for the first manned moon landings. So let's just not waste too much time, set it to 70% thrust, not flat out, activate SAS, and off we go. The first stage is powered by two of the BACC Sunfire engines, and the Twin Bore, they always forget its name, different engines, engine. And yeah, as usual, pitching. Yawing eastward to start our gravity turn. Set the SAS to probe rate. And let's just do gravity stuff. Let's just let gravity do its whatever. It was good enough. So after having jetted the two SRVs, we can set the main engine to full thrust. And I think we are flying way too steep. Yep. Yeah, this rocket has quite a good TWR, thrust to weight ratio, so we can pick a relatively flat Ascent pass, which I didn't. Once we are beyond the 36 kilometers altitude, where the SAS switches from surface to orbital orientation, we're gonna yaw all the way to horizontal, which unfortunately increases drag, not so much as you can see, but mostly I just don't like to fly sideways in the atmosphere. I prefer to fly straight forward. Yeah, this rocket, you can once again download it from the Steve Workshop, link is in the description. And it is taking the Mark II pod, or the Mark II spaceship that we already know from the last episode, and added a lander, and then a rocket large enough to carry all that stuff to the moon. So we are now coasting, already in space. And coasting towards our apoapsis at 100 kilometers, which is the height or the altitude I wanted to reach. Let's time warp until around here. And yeah, actually the simplest way to get to the moon in Kerbal Space Program would be the direct ascent, or to land the whole thing on the moon, and then bring everything back to Kerbin. But yeah, I don't like it, because I think it's called Lunar Orbit Rendezvous, what the Apollo missions did, and what I'm gonna do here is just what I'm used to from the real thing. And also, if you build a spacecraft that can land on the moon, it will just look wrong when flying in space. Or if you somehow watch this one here to land on the lunar surface, it will look wrong on the surface. So I just prefer to use dedicated landers, even if at least on the moon it actually is not the most efficient way to go. And it brings in the extra challenge of rendezvous and docking in lunar orbit, which I think might be a little bit, how to say, intimidating to new players, but they have this. And we are almost in orbit. Yeah, in reality, this would be impossible. Just starting and stopping your rocket engine like this. But this isn't reality. It's Kerbal Space Program. So our periapsis is too low. Our apoapsis is too high. So what we are going to do is time warp until around here. And then set the SAS to radial in. And by performing a maneuver radial in, or as you can see, towards the celestial body, in this case Kerbin, you are orbiting, is it will lower your orbit in front of you, or ahead of you, in this case the apoapsis, and raise the orbit behind you. In this case, it now changed apoapsis and periapsis. And we are almost circular. Not in 100 kilometers of altitude, what I wanted to do, but at least we are more or less circular. Because almost all maneuvers are easier, or almost all transfers are easier to perform from circular orbits. We are inclined by 0.7 degrees, which won't be a problem if we want to reach the moon. But once we have reached the moon, we will be in an inclined orbit, which will be the desired thing if you want to land somewhere else than on the equator. But I'm intending to land on the equator to make things more easy. So there's the ascending node, and yeah, it's almost invisible with 0.7 degrees, but basically the orbit is wrong to the north of Kerbin there, and we have to correct it to the south, which in a prograde orbit means we will have to go anti-normal, which is this button on the SAS thingy here. And yeah, a prograde orbit, I think I never mentioned it until now, means that your orbital direction is the same as the rotational direction of the body you are orbiting. And of course, if you remember the orbit tutorial, it is more efficient to launch eastwards because Kerbin is rotating eastwards, and that way we can pick up some of this rotational speed and use it. So let's time warp to the ascending node. Don't let the video get too long, but I can already predict that it will be the longest tutorial up to now. And once we are there, fire up the engine. Inclination down to 0 degrees. Yep. And yeah, if you're doing this translunar, or in this case transmunar injection from Kerbin to the moon, you don't have to fly where the moon is. Roughly, wobbler. Roughly like this, because you have to be where the moon is going to be when you are there. And this would be about like this. So let's see, we will have to, yep, like this we would be impacting the moon, which is not good. Let's do it like this. And in my first moon landing attempts, which used a totally botched spacecraft for the direct ascent way, it was basically a spaceship like this one with more fuel tanks and landing legs attached. And I was flying to the moon that way. I just placed my maneuver, went as much prograde as was necessary to somehow reach the moon like this. And yeah, it was not the best choice in many ways. And what I am gonna do now is the moon also is rotating eastward, and if we go like this, we would be in a prograde orbit, but we want to go into a retrograde orbit. I'm going to explain later why. So we, yep, that's good. And actually, if I place this maneuver now somewhere around here, it would even, our resulting orbit would even go beyond the moon. So you're burning more fuel than necessary to reach the moon, because of course you could also reach the moon if your apoapsis would be around here, and it is around here, but the difference is not so much. And it will later save a lot of fuel when going back to Kerbin. So let's just use SAS to point at our maneuver. And time warp to the next maneuver. Actually, I think the rocket that you can download from the workshop also has this RCS thrusters like this around here and some additional monopropellant tanks, because when I designed it, it was using RCS for this pointing in the right direction. Now I'm just using reaction wheels in order to save monopropellant and thus weight. Let's just check our electric charge is looking good. And 38 seconds to go to the maneuver. Let's just time warp a bit. And yeah, talking of electric charge, it's almost full, but just in case, we are carrying a fuel cell. 3, 2, 1, and go. And we can now see our apoapsis getting higher and higher, our orbit getting more and more elliptical. And what you also can see is that the required delta V is getting less and less the higher you are over Kerbin. So the difference of going to the moon, going to Minmus, or then even leaving the Kerbin system is not so much. Won't completely charge the battery anyway. And the craft that you can download from the Steam Workshop actually has no fuel cell and no custom action groups, because I designed it in career mode on a level 2 VAB where you don't have this custom action groups, and also I did not unlock fuel cells yet back then. Maybe I'm going to change it one day. So let's time warp around here. This looks a bit weird now because it shows the orbit relative to Kerbin, but the moon is also moving that way. And yeah, let's just time warp until we reach the moon's sphere of influence, or SOI. And the first day is over of this mission, and go about there. And actually, if this was an Apollo mission, we would have jettisoned this uppermost stage after having performed the injection burn. And yeah, but it still holds 296 meters per second of delta V, which will be enough to circularize, or not circularize, but at least capture into the moon orbit. Until our periapsis is kilometers, like this, and will time warp until the day or the bright side of the moon. And are going to use action group. Yeah, let's just. No, wait, better turn it pro grade. That was not good. Wait until it's calm. And set it just to stability control zone. We are going to use action group 2 and docking mode. And in the craft that you can download from the Steam Workshop, as I said, does not have the custom action group, so you have to do this by staging and manually decoupling this docking port. So let's set it as target. Control from here. And go to the rotation instead of translation. Point at the docking port. Go to translation again. Let's deactivate docking mode. Deactivate the precision control, and we will have 2 minutes until periapsis, where we would have to do yet another burn to circularize. And I think we are in danger of collision with the upper stage. We should have pointed it some other way. It was not good. Let's just see. Activate the engine, but we can do this burn without danger of collision. Oh, that was too far, because I want to be as perfect as possible in a 15-kilometer circular orbit. Yeah, that's good. So, next up, we will transfer crew. We are carrying a pilot and a scientist, and of course, we are gonna have to take the pilot, which is Isafret Kerman, and transfer her into the lander. The lander also is available separately on the Steam Workshop. And yeah, I think we can just start our descent right now. So we are going to undock. Now this, or actually it is a sandbox mode, so somehow also a scientist has the same skills as a pilot. But if you were playing in career mode, this the pod would now have no SAS anymore, so you would have to be absolutely careful not to to nudge it because then it would be spinning out of control. And to prevent that, you would have to back up the lander using RCS a little bit. The descent engine, or the only engine, deactivate RCS because you're gonna need the monopropellant later, and face retrograde. Let's just translate a bit away to prevent colliding with the pod. And to make landing easier, of course, you better pick a flat landing spot, which is not too steep, or of course as flat as possible. And if you do not have ScanSat installed, with ScanSat you could scan the surface and select a good landing spot. These large dark craters like this usually are quite a good start. There it is. And for descent from low orbit over the moon to the surface, you will need 700, maybe 800 meters per second of delta V. And as you can see, this lander has almost 2,100 meters. So yeah, it is more than enough. And of course, 700, 800 meters, something like this, is the absolute minimum. Add a little bit of safety, and yeah, we still have a bit of delta V left, so we can search for a good landing spot. So let's start up the engine. Time warp there. Engine off and deactivate RCS, deactivate docking mode, almost forgot that, and point straight up because I see that we are going to land somewhere here on the crater rim, and by just pointing upwards like this you can extend your flight path. You will land somewhere over there without increasing your speed. So this is the most efficient way to correct your landing spot. Looking good now. Let's go back to retrograde. Time warp a bit. And yeah, if you have the opposite problem, which we do not really have now, but I just want to show it, you have to burn perfectly horizontal in the way that you want to go. Like this. In the direction that you want to go. Already changed the altimeter to surface orientation and not sea level, so we can see our height above ground. Oh dear, that's too late, that's too late. No, it isn't. Of course, that was perfectly planned. Oh, that was a really hard landing. Usually I do better. So, never mind. Extend the ladder. And Isafrod Kerman can step out, be the first, or we pretend she is the first Kerbal, Kerbalina on the moon. And we can go, because I have seen it was somewhere. I have seen one of the breaking ground surface features, a crater, somewhere over there, but far away. This is mostly, I was just a bit worried about, because I haven't seen them since I updated to 1.9, and I already was afraid there was something wrong. So, of course, let's plant a flag. Never mind. Take a surface sample. And take a report. Can we see Kerbin in the sky? Because I think we are on the far side. Where you? No. We cannot see Kerbin. Because we are on the far side that of the moon that always points away from Kerbin. Interesting, but we would already need a rover to cover that sort of distance. Let's just take a nice picture for the thumbnail, but the sun is coming from straight up. So we have way more delta V left than we would need to rendezvous again with our ship. So let's head into the map view and wait until our command module is around there. Let's set it as target. Like this, roughly. So SIS is on, and we wait like this because we have so much delta V left that we are going to go into a higher orbit than the command module, and then do the rendezvous like downwards, and we descend to the lower orbit of the command module. And because of that, and it will be faster than us, it will have to be behind. But let's just set it to surface orientation. And of course, because the command module is in a retrograde orbit, we now have to go, or we now have to launch westwards on 270 here on the navbar. So let's just go. Again, quality turn. Yeah, that's too high. So we are gonna go. Radial in. And we are going to intersect with the command module over there on a distance of 1.8 kilometers. So let's already set it to target mode. And time warp until here, roughly. We are pointing retrograde from the target to there it is. Coming closer at over 400 meters per second. We did too much. So anyway, let's point at our target. To get closer. Point retrograde, and once we are close, we will have to fire up the engine in a retrograde way to bring the relative speed to zero. Which is about... No. So let's again set the view to locked. Very close. The relative speed is zero, so we have achieved rendezvous. And let's dock again. Of course, being very careful not to nudge the command module, because it would start spinning out of control. But we have docked. So now I think it was action group 4 to collect all the science in here inside the service module. And let's have Isa Frot Kerman head back into the command module. And now what I mentioned before, that the retrograde orbit will help us to get back to Kerbin. Because if we created our maneuver, let's do it here. Not too much. Yeah, like this. Maneuver is coming up in 1 minute and 20 seconds roughly, so very soon we can undock. I like to undock very shortly before the maneuver to then turn around the command module and the engine blast then will push away the lander like this and it will go suborbital and eventually crash into the surface. Which is very nice if you have set up some seismic experiments from the Breaking Ground DLC. Or from the surface experiments package. So let's undock. It's already looking good. Yep, there you can see the lander going to crash into the lunar surface. And as you can see, our escape maneuver from the moon pillars will now put us into this highly elliptical orbit around Kerbin with a low heliopsis. And if we were in a prograde orbit around the moon, going eastwards, our escape maneuver from the moon actually will put us higher than we were before, and we would then need to burn fuel to bleed off this height. So that's why it is easier or more efficient to... It is not easier, but it is more efficient to launch into a retrograde orbit over the moon. So let's go, or let's time warp ahead to periapsis. It already set SAS to retrograde. To reduce our height to 75 kilometers and go back to low Kerbin orbit. Still is the KV-3 Mark II test project from the last video. I didn't land the two spaceships yet. Yep. And let's time warp ahead to periapsis. in order to lower our apoapsis. A little bit radial in to lower our apoapsis and raise our periapsis. And there we are, a nice 75 km orbit. So, one last thing to do before landing is open. Hoppla. Ah, I can look inside. Never mind. Let's just engage it and blow this the service module and the scientist. Now can spacewalk out. Yeah, this is also something that requires a little bit of practice, this EVA controls. And collect the experiments from the experiment storage. There you can see the fuel cell that I have added. So let's head back into the command module. And time warp. Over here, roughly. Now, maybe I should have done this shortly before the orbit burn. Just to not so long look at this ugly open service module. Yeah, that should do it. So let's perform the orbit burn by firing up the engine one last time until we fly roughly like this, maybe a bit more. So just to make sure that we land in the ocean or to splash down in the ocean. And let's check the service module and wait until we hit the atmosphere. Just waiting till there it is. You can see the lights of the KSC, so we are definitely gonna do a splashdown, which is most important. Of course it would be perfect to land just there over or just there off the KSC, but that's not going to happen today. I think with 1.9 it became darker. And now you can see a little bit, you can see the coastline very slightly. There it is. Time warp a bit again. Waiting for the parachutes to deploy. There is our service module. And parachute. The service module also has two parachutes because back when I designed this this rocket, the RCS thruster still used to be ridiculously expensive. So I like to recover the service module as well in order to get some refunds for the RCS thrusters. And also this is a little bit of a backup in case maybe I forget to transfer the scientific data from the experiment storage unit over there into the command pod over here, so you still can recover the science perhaps. Sometimes the experiment storage gets destroyed on touchdown or splashdown, of course. And Isafrod and Magrik come and gently splash down at 8 meters per second into the ocean far off the KSC. We overshot a little. But never mind. So that's how, or one way, maybe not the easiest way, but my favorite way to fly to the moon. And it is not very hard, or actually very easy once you get the hang of it. And yeah, if you enjoyed the video, I always appreciate a like on this video. And you can also check out this channel and my main channel, and if you like them, I appreciate a subscription.